So, maybe everyone believes that just because the Giants, San Francisco Giants, have won the pennant, that I've been goofing off and, right, not really paying attention to what needs to be paid attention to. Well, the answer to that is no, I have not been goofing off at all. Just the opposite. Of course, just the opposite. What I've been doing is studying history. Wikipedia enables a very interesting way to study history. If you're able to do it without reacting and not getting pulled into too many details, and you have to know how to manage and everything, but you can really, it can be a very effective tool actually. Now, I've studied history my entire life, but it never seemed to be able to quite get it at all. You know, anyway, that's what I've been doing, very intensely studying history. Now, this is all about non-dual teaching, these videos really. How do we get free of suffering? This is what it's about. History is suffering. The more you study it, the more sick of it you get. Okay, it gets to a certain point, you have to quit. It's so terrible. It's revolting, actually. But there's some overview. What I'm doing is an overview of the whole history. I basically divide it, birth of Christ, zero. Okay, before that, before the birth of Christ, after the birth of Christ, 2,000 years before, 2,000 years after. You can loosely divide history in that way. Of course, we have the Paleolithic, the Old Stone Age, the Stone Age, etc. The Bronze Age is when things start popping, basically. So that's about 2,000 years ago. Syntastic, Andronova culture, and the Indo-Aryan migrations, you know, we'll just say 2,000 years, birth of Christ. 2,000 more years. So it's funny, the birth of Christ is kind of in the middle of this cycle that we're in. Now this cycle is coming to an end, essentially. And we're basically morphing into something, fourth dimension is what we're morphing into. Very, very different. Very, very different. Except, it's just a repackaging of duality, is what it really is. And the misery continues. Now, what is the problem? What is the problem with you? What is the problem? Well, there is an answer to this. What is our problem? If you look at history and you come away shaking your head, it's just, my God, it's just unbelievable. I mean, the history of conflict, the history of struggle, the history of misery. What is our problem? Okay, there's an answer to that. There is an answer to that. I know the answer to it. But it's basically, we've been incredibly stupid. And we continue to be incredibly stupid. And you can trace the stupidity back. And there's one stupid, silly mistake that we are making. However, even behind that is the continuity fear. Because everything we've been doing is based on this stupid mistake. Once we realize the mistake, we still say, oh my gosh, but what do I do with all this activity and world? And, you know, that's the continuity fear. So there's a stupid mistake, and then there's a pragmatic situation, is what our situation really is. So what is the stupid mistake? Very simple. And yet, it's virtually unknown. So we need to be, I always emphasize, in a mood of repentance, realizing there's some really stupid mistake that we're making. And stop going after sophistication and being a slave to vanity in this world. The world is nothing but vanity, actually. Realize that we are making a very stupid mistake, a so simple mistake. It comes from the belief in determinism, that one moment determines the next. Okay, that there's process, that moments are linked. Now, actually, this is not true. And yet, this world appears as for sure it must be true. This world is an elaborate, super creative mirage that spirit is imagining, actually. So from the level of ideas and abstraction, we need to accept that reality is completely indeterminate, which means that each moment is exactly how we want it to be. There's no past moment that prevents us from experiencing what we want right now. And this moment right now is not going to prevent us from what we want to experience in some other moment. This is called indeterminate, totally indeterminate, pure indeterminate, total spontaneity in the moment, in the now, as Longchenpa would put it. This is reality. Now, what we're doing, if you look at this world of nature, what we're doing is we're trying to change what we are. We're trying to change reality. So we're having a dream of determinancy, meaning that moments do determine, the past determine this moment, and this moment will help determine the future. This is called determinancy. And nature is a dream of determinancy, actually. It's an attempt for us to change what we are, which is futile. We cannot. Now, when we hear this, we say, okay, great, I need to drop determinacy. And here's this mistake we make. All right, it's very simple. What we say is, oh, if we drop determinacy, then the next moment is going to be a void. There's going to be nothing there. Because, now, okay, let's just stop here for a moment. Full stop in the now. This is the mistake we're making. And that's the only mistake we're making. This is the mother of all mistakes. Mother of all stupidity. And yet it goes virtually unchallenged in our belief, you see. This is the root mistaken belief. Now we still have a continuity problem. Even though we look at this and can clear it up, we still have a continuity problem, but we understand that. But we're looking at this root mistake. And so, believing in determinism, we say, well, if we drop determinism, the next moment will be a void, nothing there. But that itself is a conclusion from determinism. Okay? That itself is a conclusion from the false belief in determinism. Meaning, well, each moment is determined by the past. It's a product of the past. So if we say, well, there is no product of the past because determinism was never true, then we claim, well, since there's no momentum from the past, determinate momentum from the past, if we drop and realize there is no momentum, we claim that the next moment will be completely void of anything. See? How? You start to say, wait a minute. There's something doesn't add up here, right? Of course it doesn't. All it means is this next moment will be exactly as we want it to be. You see, that's all it means. And in fact, each moment is already exactly as we want it to be, except when we drop determinism, we won't feel constrained to keep the next moment very similar to the previous moment, almost exact replica. This replication of moments, 666 replication of moments, the beast is determinism. We say, you know what? Because of the continuity fear, I think it's a good idea if we pretty much replicate the last moment. But we're not attached to this. We don't feel without this replication somehow we'll have a void. Not at all. Not at all. But pragmatically, because of the continuity fear, okay, let's more or less replicate it in most instances. This is the entire root of all our troubles, other than the continuity, the root of it, and then the continuity fear is the effect of this stupidity. We've been bound by this for so long. So just let this sink in. We just in no hurry here because this is very important. It's what dominates our conclusions. It's the false premise that dominates our conclusions that we draw. So we feel like we're being dominated by something from within, right? That something has a grip on us that we feel we just can't shake. This is the feeling we have in this world. We get manipulated by the vanity of nature. Because of this, say, oh, the fear of the void. Oh my gosh, if I drop the momentum, a belief in determinism, which is belief in momentum, isn't it? Belief in structure, belief in form, belief in process. If I drop this, then the next moment will be void. You see, there won't be anything there because, well, we believe each moment, all the past moments are determining this moment. And without all that past, there wouldn't be this moment. You see, so if we say, well, the past is we're dropping it, all the momentum of that, realizing it was never valid, or we're no longer going to believe in it, then we conclude, through the reasoning of determinism, we conclude the next moment will be void of any characteristics whatsoever, just a total void. Completely false conclusion. Totally false conclusion. Now, the next moment, like all moments, we'll be free to be exactly what we want it to be. And we won't want it to be void. If we insist upon it, it could appear to be void. But the inherent greatness of reality, we cannot void that out. It's just very important that the very nature of reality has this inherent feel of inherent greatness to it. So you cannot fall into any void. The void is a conceptual belief from determinism. That determinism actually gives rise to this belief in a void. Thinking that that's what happens when we drop determinism. There is no void. It's impossible. Reality, the very nature of reality, is inherently blissful. Has this inherent feeling of greatness. Of perfection. Whatever we choose to experience or not experience, it's inherently there. There's this inherent feeling of being, the opposite of a void. In fact, it's not even the opposite of a void. There is no void. It's impossible. The void is only in our beliefs, where we have a belief in that there's a void from the belief in determinism. So from this belief that we'll fall into a void comes this desperate attempt to maintain our belief in determinism. And that's then what we do is we end up serving vanity, because vanity is the dynamic that drives this belief in determinism, which is attraction to form. See, the attraction to quote-unquote form is what drives determinism, which is what protects us from what we believe is falling into a total void. So we become slaves to vanity, the vanity of what we call nature, the vanity of form, attraction to form. And it goes, the yin-yang of that attraction, this we're desperate. All this belief system is desperate to continue to be attracted by form. So there are the two poles of that. That's what that which is appearing to be attractive, and that which is attracted to it. You see, that's called the male and female, so to speak. Both dynamics there are. The fear is driving both those dynamics. The women, for instance, say, well, I just can't resist trying to appear to be attractive, vanity. And the men say, I just can't resist being attracted to that vanity. You see, I just can't resist it. It just seems to be irresistible. Although, later on, they may think, like, how in the world was I ever attracted to that? That's absolutely crazy. I must have been under some sort of spell. You know? the yin and the yang, male and female, the dance of attraction is the dance of attraction to form, which is a desperate attempt to avoid what we believe is falling into a void, total voidness, be voided out. And so history is just the dance of this attraction, dance of vanity. As Shakespeare said, all is vanity, which is true. Nature is nothing but this ceaseless vanity of attraction to form. It's attraction to form, because form seems to be determinant, right? So we're trapped, we think we're trapped in determinacy. And if we don't remain in it, we think we'll be voided out. So we're in this hideous cycles of nature, what we call, which is hideous cycles of vanity, attraction to form. And we just continue on with it and continue on and continue on and continue on. Same old, same old, same old, same old. If you look at history, it's the same old dance. It's the same old dance. And never more so than now, actually, where vanity is the new world religion. And there's just this obsession now with form, with bodies. And whoever is expert at making bodies seem attractive, whoever is expert in servants of vanity, both ways, those are the ones that are lionized in this day and age as very important for society and for culture and for the world. Right? All of this arises, this whole mess we call history, and the whole mess we call the future, which is just more vanity, more vanity, more body, more attraction to form, more attraction to form, continually repackaging the form and feeling like we're just enslaved by this, even though we don't want to. I know both male and female, they're sick of it. They're sick of it. The females are sick of, God, I gotta do my hair, my makeup, my nails, my jewelry, my body language, my dress. I've got to appear, you know, to feel like in the grip no matter what they do. You know, we hear the talk, I remember in the 60s, 70s, the feminists said, oh, forget vanity, you know, we're through with it. Well, what happened a few years later? All these leading feminists were marrying like super rich men and totally vain again, you know. Can't get out of the grip of it. All this rhetoric, oh, we're going to communism, for instance, Chinese communism was supposedly going to wipe out vanity, you know, everybody's wearing the same Maoist suit, you know what I mean? Now look at China, you know, getting caught up in a frenzy of vanity. Can't escape it. And then men say, no, I'm not going to be attracted by any of this vanity of the world, you know, and you say you're not. And then for too long you look and say, oh, it's like, wow, this world's, you know, look at the attractiveness of women, of the world. It's like, oh yeah, really attractive, you see. Continuity fear, fear of the void, keeps pulling us into vanity without question. And we will certainly only get free of this when we are able to directly work on our continuity fear, really work on it, evaporate it, really look at the root of our problem, really listen to non-dual truth. Not through the vanity of history, okay, directly, right now. See, Jesus saves today. He's alive today, okay. Non-dual truth is alive right now, you see. The awareness of non-dual truth is here with us right now. So don't try to find it in the vanity of history. It is found right now. So, to that, and you try to minimize the dance of vanity in your life. You try to minimize it. You try not to be the attractive pole of vanity. And you try not to be the one who's attracted to the vanity, you see. Both. On the same hand, you take the middle path. You don't try to prove a point about it, you know. It's just You just try to be just kind of a... someone nobody pays any attention to, and you don't really pay attention to anyone else so much. You're just a kind of nameless, faceless part of the crowd, and just let it be, and then focus in on non-dual teaching. Focus in. Bring your attention. Don't let your attention scatter. I remember when the Giants just won the pennant on some incredibly dramatic walk-off home run. I saw it, and I just remained completely calm and non-reactive. Of course, I said, oh, yeah, great. But inside, it was just steady, smooth, calm. Didn't affect me. Didn't affect my nerves or anything. It's huge progress. Of course, you win in Rome, do as Romans do, so to speak. So you say, oh, yeah, go Giants. Yeah, that's great. Talk. But my overall reaction was just full stop in the now, just saying full stop. So see, the discipline carries over. So you don't have to like pretend to be some religious ascetic or something, casting the vanity of the world aside. What you have to do is actually in your practice, in your reactions, etc., in your attention, discipline your attention. And then you can just, you know, pretend, oh yeah, the vanity world, that's great, yeah. But you're not really reacting to it at all. Your attention is still on the prize. Your eye is on the prize. That's the best way. Otherwise, you feel like a caricature of yourself. It doesn't work very well. So, pragmatically, what's called the middle path, pragmatically, in Buddhism, middle path, pragmatically, that's actually very good advice. I've been a seeker of good advice in my life so I can pass it on to others. That's very good advice. In other words, don't go in front of a grocery store in a white robe and sit there in lotus posture and try to show everybody, I'm meditating, I don't have any vanity, I have vanity. I was all these very vain people going in and out the grocery store. You know, don't try to shame people like that and make a spectacle of yourself. You know, just go in the grocery store, you're humble, you go about your business, get your groceries, check it out, go back to the car, go back home and get back to study. People just don't really have any conclusions about you one way or the other. Central mistake we're making is the belief if we drop our belief in determinism, we will then automatically be catapulted into a void. Whereas the fact is, we will realize the inherent bliss of reality. The inherent greatness of it, the inherent smoothness of it, the inherent stability of it. And this is called, they say, the enlightenment, self-realization, is this some sort of feeling of, wow, everything is perfectly okay, there is no pit, no void to fall into. There's no deterministic reality whatsoever. See, the problem of the dualists is they believe that there's a not indeterminate reality and a determinate reality. And they're at war with each other. This is not true. It seems that way, doesn't it? But it is not true at all. And the world is dualistic. I mean, the belief system of this world is most people in this world are extremely dualistic. They're basically what I call Mencian, from Mencius, which is was one of the main synthesizers and clarifiers of Confucianism, actually. And it basically says is that your happiness Success is dependent on your environment, your upbringing, and your education, where you are, environment, you know, nature versus nurture. It's basically nurture, the nurturing you get. Most of the world feels very much this way. But actually, happiness is completely intrinsic and indeterminate nature of reality. And happiness doesn't exist really in the belief in determinism, dualism. Doesn't really exist at all. So seeking it in that way is futile. So the whole Confucian ideology, which is really permeating the world right now, where we're essentially, it's interesting, in the United States, it's going more and more a Confucian country, actually, because all the trade with China, the permeation of the United States by China and the whole world by it, because all its products and all its merchants, it's an ideology, you know, from Japan, Korea, that whole area is very Confucian in their belief that the structuring society in just a certain way. It's very bureaucratic, super, you know, limiting as far as what your role is. You have to know exactly what your role is in society and stuff. The whole world's becoming that way. That's why the New World Order is this vast controlling bureaucracy that will basically, you know, make the whole world like a Confucian utopia, thinking that if everybody just knows their duty, you know, everything's going to work great. If everyone just gets the right education, if everyone just gets the right nurturing, we'll all be happy. But we'll all still have this terrible fear of the void, you see. And this terrible fear of the void drives this intense desire to keep being attracted to form. And that dynamic trumps any teaching whatsoever in this world as far as how to find happiness within duality. So, you know. It's a pipe dream. A utopia driven by this extreme dread of the void is a pipe dream. You know, this should be, you know, at some level, this has to register with everybody. But no, it can't happen. And look at history. My gosh, so many, many, many situations have been set up which everyone thinks, okay, now we've got it. Now we found happiness. The new rulers are here, the new teaching, everything, okay. Stable kingdom, this is great. Now we're happy. You know, how long does it last? 20 years. Whoops, the ruler died. Struggle for succession. The aunt, grandmothers, mothers, aunts, and then the uncles and their mothers and aunts. And the whole hive thing, you know, is all struggling for their vanity. You know, how do we avoid the void? How do we avoid the void? You know, struggle. So, how do we avoid the void? Attraction to form. We need to conquer. We need more goods to keep us more attracted to form. We need to go conquer our neighbors. You know, we need to win. We need to get stuff. We need more beautiful clothes and jewelry. We need more wonderful food and entertainment. We need to keep attraction to form is the horrible sickness, the prison that we have, which is only based on a false belief in the void. The continuity problem can be resolved and dissolved and evaporated for sure. Absolutely. It's our fear of the void that has really, you know, has been driven to our vanity, attraction to form. John, the maybe apocryphal story, but we don't know, John the Baptist. Was it Salome or the daughter of Herod or something like that? There's so many rulers and potentates in history, you know, it's all the same story, really. And John the Baptist said, hey, vanity of this world, you know, the truth is indeterminate. And Salome, he said, didn't like that because she was so wrapped up in vanity. You know, desperately attract the attention of Herod so I can get more beautiful. Feel like I'm being protected from the void because I'm attracting to form, others being attracted to me. This is vanity that we're stuck in. She said, what I want is John the Baptist's head on a platter. You know, I want him out of here because He brings up this fear in me. What fear? Fear of the void. Also continuity fear. Ultimately, even when we see the void is not true, we still have a continuity fear. But the continuity fear can be looked at through reason, and we can practice and we can dissipate it, okay? It's very doable. Whereas the fear of the void, we think if we fall in the void, nothing's doable. So what we need to do is we need to transfer the fear of the void. Say, I don't have a void problem, I have a continuity problem. Transfer all that fear over the continuity problem where it's manageable. See, the continuity problem is, what we're seeing is we're not going to get rid of form, at least what we believe is form, which is really just a replication of each moment. We're going to keep it, except in the form of supernature. And when we hear this, they say, oh, okay. It's not a big deal. I can handle this. It's our false premise of the void, which we feel we can't handle at all. So, someone who's repentant is someone who realizes, you know what, that I am making that silly, stupid mistake. There's no real void. It's not true. And then they turn to start working on the continuity problem. And the spiritual path, of middle path, exercise, a skillful means to evaporate the continuity problem. Understanding the goal is supernature. See, absolutely. Where we replicate this form of nature each moment, in such a way that there's no need for the dance of attraction of form, no need for vanity. It's completely stable. And the greatness of the greatness of reality shines through this and evaporates all remaining fear of ultimately of formlessness, which is, you know, indeterminateness, totally indeterminate. Total spontaneity. We lose our fear of this, of total spontaneity, ultimately through the intermediate step of supernature. And that's what Jesus was pointing out to us, is supernature. It says this is an intermediate step for you. So we're able to get this once we begin to realize we've made this silly mistake. So, but it's helpful to bring it to light here. We need to really just look at it and just say, okay. But if you don't look at it and you don't know about the continuity problem, then you're just driven by vanity. Keep this in mind. You're driven by vanity the way that a dry leaf is driven by the wind. And you're frantic, become frantic to keep this dance of attraction going. So those in this world who serve the serve vanity, this vanity, again, are seen as super helpful at this time in the world. Super necessary. Very important and necessary. This is why you see society, the restructuring of society. What's really happening is a restructuring of society away from religion, which is really evaporating the continuity fear. The whole purpose of religion is the momentum to evaporate the continuity fear, which leads to freedom from the belief in momentum. Discipline of attention. Religion is simply the discipline of attention to putting your eye on the prize of supernature and evaporating the continuity fear. Repent, 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 realizing there is no void. Okay, there is no void whatsoever. Habits of attention. Religion is good habits of attention. This is what it's all about. Without those good habits of attention, you got no chance. Now, let's not make it too difficult here. Let's just stay simple. What we're in this right now in this age is a fundamental shift of culture and society into a globalized culture, which shifts off of religion onto vanity, back onto vanity, which is going back to the, of course, barbaric phase of history. That's why I call it the end of the church age, We are now cultivating very, very bad habits of attention. As a world. This is not even in dispute at all. This is absolute fact. What we're doing is strengthening vanity. Habits of vanity instead of habits of evaporating our continuity fear. Fundamentally different. Fundamentally different. So again, as a world culture, we are exchanging the habits of attention we call religion for the habits of attention we call vanity. And it's a very weird time, very weird time. But this, in a nutshell, is exactly what's happening. And of course, though in those who serve vanity, they're very confident that they're doing on the right path. Just like a look through history, all those wars and conquests, which is just ceaseless. Each effort of conquest, the people involved always think that they're on the right path to happiness, to success, to stability, to finally getting free of this fear. Because why? They think that they could just get a hold of form the way they want it, that somehow this fear inside of them is going to vanish. And yet, like Alexander the Great, you know, you never can conquer enough, and I gotta conquer more. I can't stop. Napoleon, I can't stop. I don't quite have it yet. What they want is a stable determinism. No such thing, because determinism doesn't really exist at all. So, they say pride goes before a fall. It's really vanity goes before a fall. And the belief that we're you know, just about almost ready to grab what we need. And it's just always this way. I'm almost ready to grab what I need. Oh, wait, I've got this version of the smartphone. Okay, I thought this was it, but it's almost it. Oh, there's the next version. That's it. I just gotta get that one. And of course, these marketers and corporations know exactly that we're slaves to this vanity, and they just manipulate and exploit us. So what we really have is a very exploitive culture. This global corporate culture is super exploitive. And there's no culture more exploited than the technology culture. They're the worst by far. And this is what is, you know, gripped the planet. Because it seems like it's opening vistas of being able to grab more. Easier. And you get then this massive amount of hackers, people stealing your identity. Instead of becoming more secure, we become way less secure in fundamental ways. Of having our identity stolen, of having our bank information stolen, having our bank account wiped out, having our computer hacked, viruses crashing our whole computer, everything's on there, our whole life's on there. You know, did I back up enough? Oh, I forgot my password. But of course, vanity is telling us that this is what we want, and this is this. They've got the answer for us, and we, like lemmings, we can't resist. We cannot resist. We are the lemmings, okay? And the corporate culture is like the cliff. This and high technology, this global corporate high technology synthesis is the cliff. The lemmings are going off of the cliff. We can't resist the siren call of vanity, which is attraction to form. And we keep trying the wrong way. Okay, well, it doesn't work. The way that works is right discipline of attention, which means, quote unquote, various religious structures, institutions, teachings, various religious books, ways, right attention, right habits of attention, which get the attention on the simple truth of reason, of continuity fear, and of this false belief in the void, difference between belief in determinism and in the reality of indeterminism. That's the way. That's the way. Well, what we do is we do it in the wrong way. For instance, we say let's overcome vanity. So like, let's say, for instance, the women said, okay, we're going to be super modest. We're going to get rid of all vanity. We're just going to not wash our hair, just put it in a ponytail or cut it, and no makeup, no jewelry, no clothes, just a simple charcoal shirt waist dress, and just look, no vanity whatsoever. And men say, great. That's what we want. And after a while, you know, it's like they just are sitting there and say, wow, I feel nervous, you know, I feel anxious and something. And says, well, why don't we go out tonight? And why don't you dress up a little bit, you know? And you know, before too long, the men are saying, wow, you know, I really, you know, I'm looking at some other woman, looks so wonderful and be attractive. I say, wow, there's more attractive there. And so the women say, forget it, you know, and vice versa. Where the men say, I'm just going to cut off all attraction to vanity, and women say, great. And then after a while, they say, hey, you're not really attracted to me anymore. I'm really nervous. And they start, you know, I got to make myself more attractive, you know. So it works through both male and female, absolutely 100%. And we cannot really, trying to differentiate it and say, well, one is, it needs to be better than the other, and this is, you can't put the blame on either, really. It's really this fear of the void, the spiritual fear of the void, which is driving this need to be attracted to form. Attraction to form and attraction to form. Attractive form, attraction to form. Subjective, objective. The dance of duality, you see, like that. So we've experimented many times with both male and female agreeing to try to cut back on vanity. Our one side saying we're going to cut back on, the other side saying, okay, hope, okay, let me help you that way. It never works. It never works. You go back to it again. This is something that you learn from history. You know, the rise of feminism in the 60s, especially the 70s and the 80s, I thought, hey, finally the women are deciding, forget vanity, we're finished with it. I said, this is great. This is really going to help everyone. And then a little while later, I said, oh my gosh, they're looping back into a new form of vanity, which is even more intense. You know, look at my body, now I'm like so toned, I'm so yogaed out, you know, I'm so sleek, and you know, you realize, oh my gosh, it vanished like water into a desert, gone, replaced by even worse vanity. And so you realize that this approach doesn't work. This is fundamentally a flawed approach. It's manipulating effects. It's trying to solve the problem on the level of effects instead of cause. We have to find out what is causing this vanity. And it's the sphere of the void. And what is causing us to cling to the sphere of the void, the continuity problem? How do we solve the continuity problem? Right habits of attention, for sure. Which is really, in all its forms, meditation, contemplation, prayer, meditation, study, full stop in the now, managing your success. It's called the path. The path of attention, the path of right attention. It's a path. It's a struggle because the continuity fear is so strong. Ultimately, we're going towards this perfection of indeterminacy, realizing ultimately that we're totally free. We're totally glorious. We're totally perfect. Everything is, you know, it's just like so perfect. We just like, we're afraid of it. So we have a severe continuity problem. And this is what is overlooked. Why people give up the religious spiritual, religious path, the path of right attention. They give it up because they say, well, you know, how come I'm not getting what I'm happy? Well, because happiness is unassailable, actually. Reality is unassailable. It's perfect. This is what frightens us. This is what frightens us. So what I'm doing is I'm shifting the entire landscape of spiritual practice and teaching around this continuity fear and saying the continuity fear is our real problem. It's a practical problem. See, the void, fear of the void is just a mistake that we're making. And we can look at that and see, this is a logical mistake. I see where the mistake is. But even so, we still have a practical continuity problem. And this is what people do not realize yet. And this is why they quit, they give up, they think that maybe this is all just a myth, you know, and they go back to vanity. They go back to vanity. And we all sort of ping pong back and forth, you know, from the path to vanity, from the path to vanity. It's hard to stabilize the path because if we don't understand it's a continuity fear problem, we will keep giving up. We'll say, wait a minute, you know, the void is still there. So, but what we're doing is we're thinking that our continuity fear, transferring that back into the belief system of determinism, and then which Dick tells us, well, that's it's fear of the void. It's really fear of the non-void. if you bring it to full fruition, it's fear of the contrast. We think, oh my gosh, I'm going to fall into a void. And what you find out is there's a complete absence of void. In fact, it's totally perfect, totally stable. It's so great. You know, it's just the contrast. It is so extreme for us. That's called a continuity problem. How do we go from thinking that we're going to step into this complete void and we step into the total absence of any void? You know, just absolute perfect perfection without any possibility that we could ever be otherwise for us. This is a shocking situation. And unless we are clear about this whole situation, we're going to react to it in a determinant way. We're going to say, okay, well, where did this come from? What past gave rise to this? And where is this going to lead to in the future? You know, not realizing we're experiencing the inherent nature of reality, which is always the same. It's always there. The inherent greatness of reality is all we're experiencing. It doesn't come from the past. It doesn't need to be produced in the future. There's nothing determinate that needs to take place at all for this to be so. So right habits of attention means sitting quietly, hearing this, managing reactions to it, managing your success, because ultimately you realize, oh my gosh, this is right. I there is no void. This is wonderful. It's like, uh-oh, this is too good. The news is too good. So the spiritual path, path of right attention is really managing, hearing great good news. That's what it is. Now, if this is the case, then what is the world doing of vanity? It's all about managing the path of really bad news. Okay. Now, I've stopped listening to the news. It's been quite some time since I've checked into the news. Now, I picked up a newspaper, look at the sports, and the Giants won the pennant, it was great. And then you look over here, you know, and they've got some bad news here, and then below, bad news. And then It says, look for the giant story on the other page. I look, and then here's terrible news, here's terrible news, here's horrible news. Okay, so the news is serving this dread that we have of great good news. It's serving to keep you away from the good news. And it shows a severe unacknowledged continuity problem. Severe unacknowledged continuity problem. An unrepentant attitude. Because if you're repentant, you realize, oh, I don't need the bad news. I don't need it. The problem is good news. So I don't need to keep twisting it into bad news to turn my attention away from the good news. Really, all this bad news is our attempt, desperate attempt to stay away from the good news. And this is what's really happening. The sickness, the problems, etc., all of that's designed in our lives is just to keep us away from the good news. Because beyond fear of the void, which we can easily point out is not true, is the fear of the non-void. It's a greater fear, actually. It's a greater fear, the fear of the non-void, the perfect non-void, the perfect impossible of any voidness, the realization that you are eternally one with all life, with all truth, with all beauty, with all safety, with all peace, with all freedom, with all love, you are eternally one with that, with all. Everyone is totally safe in this eternal oneness. All companions in spirit. Endless glory is yours. To realize this, you know, is just like, and to be used to a determinate context, you see. You say, well, how do I stuff this back into a determinate context? So, so I avoid the void, you know. It sort of goes together. Continuity, fear, and the fear of the void kind of reinforce one another. Because when you experience this vision of oneness, you say, well, where did that come from, determinant-wise? Because you're thinking, maybe there's a void somewhere, you know, because if I can't figure out how this took place from the past and then project it into the future, I'm afraid, you know, I'll fall into a void because there's nothing determinate here. See, so it's kind of like there is also a fear of the void, and the continuity fears tend to kind of reinforce one another is what I'm seeing here. So our emphasis is on the inherent greatness of reality without any need for any specific appearance whatsoever or any specific experiencing whatsoever. This is what Longchenpa has pointed out, is this inherent greatness of reality. No matter what we're choosing to experience, no matter what, or choosing to not experience. Remember, we're spirit. We are fundamentally active. So even when we say, well, I'm not experiencing, we're actually actively saying, well, I don't want to experience any of this stuff. That's still an experience. We're still being active. And then we say, I want to experience this. He's saying, I don't want to experience this. It's also active. So spirit is active. It's the experiencer. It's the one who wants to experience. So even if it says, well, I want to void, the inherent greatness of reality, of being, of oneness, is still completely there. Spirit can't get away from what it is. It's not possible. But the capacity to look at this, it comes from right habits of attention. It doesn't just come by luck. So, the testimony of the ages is this conclusion in terms of situation. I mean, there have been many who become very aware of what the situation is here and said, hey, folks, right habits of attention are essential for you. Even in the midst of all this vanity, you have to make efforts to draw your attention to this all-important dynamic of the continuity fear, fear of total perfection, and then also the fear of the void as we drop the belief in determinacy. And this has to be ultimately resolved through this intermediate step of ultimately supernature, you would call it. All this has been known throughout history. And it's known right now. It's known right now. As I say, Jesus saves the day. See, Jesus didn't forget all this. Right? It's very simple. He knows this truth today as he did before and before and before. Buddhism also knows the truth. Buddha knew the truth, absolutely. And there are other, you know, there's other knowers of this truth. There's other knowers of this truth. And we have all sorts of problems that arise, which I have seen. But I'll tell you this, if you could get your attention focused on what we're talking about right now, these other issues will not bother you. You see the idea, well, Jesus is the only one. I had a dream last night that showed me this problem here. Because what we're trying to say is that it's possible for the indeterminate to become determinate. Okay. And it's possible for reality to be both indeterminate and determinate. And what we believe is a savior figure is one who makes it both for us. Okay. So we believe Jesus is a savior figure who has done both, is both divine and human, meaning indeterminate and determinate. And then we say, but he's the only one there is, which is what? A conclusion of determinism, right? In other words, this can't change. This is absolutely determinate. There is no trying to make determinate permanent. See, this is the only one. There's just one who can make indeterminate determinate. And so now that's finished. It is now, has taken place, and this is it. You can see this delusion now. The indeterminate cannot become determinate at all. Determinism is a mirage. It doesn't even exist. You cannot be both divine and human because there's only divinity. There is no real human condition whatsoever. It's a mirage entirely. So, but when you're able to look at this at this level, all these theological fights in history and stuff, don't even arise, I'm telling you this. There's this clock, some kind of really interesting clock in the dream I had. And I went up there, and some marketer salesman said, no, don't touch that. He says, oh, there's only one who can deal with that. There's only one that can touch that. And being the way I am, I touched it. And there's like dials within dials, kind of. And I moved it, and it just floated effortlessly. And I moved this, and it floated. There was no friction at all, you know. It was like perfect indeterminacies, no friction. I said, wow, if you just touch this the slightest bit, it just moves perfectly with no friction. What do they call that? Anyway, no friction here, no friction. And I said, huh. So how is it possible for this to be a clock, determinate, in other words, determinate, time, tick, 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 tick. And I said, and someone was telling me, there's only one person, and that one was sent by the Father, and that one knows how to deal with this, and no one else can deal with this, you know. Interesting, because by saying nobody else can deal with it, that means you're not supposed to touch it, and you're not supposed to find out that actually nobody can deal with it. It's indeterminate. There's no determinacy there. It cannot be a clock. And I found that out because I said I'm going to see what's going on. So again, what's happened with Jesus is he's been put into a determinant context as the savior of determinism. And what Jesus said, there is no determinism. So how can I be the savior of it? You see, it's not true. Very important. He's talking about determinism. He's talking about nature. He's talking about this world, this dream of determinism. He said, I did not come to save the world. I did not come to bring peace to the world. I did not come to save the world. I came to condemn it. To condemn it. And I guess we've just said, no, again, I don't hear that. No, we came to make determinism real, you know, and then by being both divine and human, this made determinism real, and it's done, finished. See, they don't want anybody else questioning it. So that's it. This is it. There's not going to be another one ever, because it's already been done. If there's another one, then people start thinking, wait a minute, maybe it's not determinant. So this is the problem with determinant, this situation we're in. But if we're able to look at it like we're looking at it here, that stuff doesn't bother us at all anymore. All this horrible theological struggles and battles throughout history, which I spent a lifetime studying, and I'm so sick and tired of it, none of that bothers you at all. You see right through it. It's, again, determinism, insisting on that it be the fundamental context of interpreting religion, interpreting truth, interpreting teaching. It's like someone comes to determinism and says, there is no determinism. And determinism says, oh, okay, that's great. But if you want to help me, let me see, you want to help me? Okay, so you're here to say that both are true, right? That's what you're saying. Or you make, but this is the exception. You make an exception. and they say, no, you've got it. It's like fitting a round peg into a square hole or something. They say, you've got to fit in with determinism here, because we need you to. That's the only way you can help us. Not true. Not true. So really, the teachings of Jesus have not permeated this situation very much, because we're still stuck on the continuity fear and the sphere of the void. So real religious teaching is to put your attention on this continuity issue and the fear of the void. Continuity problem, fear of the void. And they see they're mutually, they interact with one another. And they reinforce one another, mutually reinforcing. And it's not easy to do this, because the fear, the mutual reinforcing fear, is like, wow, what if I'm successful? This is the problem. What if I'm successful? So what we do is we make sure that we're not successful. Okay, which means that we throw all sorts of objections and confusions and stuff, and we put the brakes on. We try desperately to go slow as possible, because we're afraid, oh my gosh, if I'm successful, I'll be plunged into absolute perfect happiness forever, and it's too much. So the world, we try to avoid success, really. We try, as I say, the religion of this world is failure. There's no question about it. It's, in a nutshell, religion of this world is failure. And we celebrate failure, we insist on failure, we demand failure from everyone here. And we feel that failure is success. We feel that remaining attracted to form, vanity, remaining in the clutches of vanity, is success. And since we say it's success, we say, well, it must bring happiness. This is a false reasoning, okay? It's reasoning from avoidance, from fear, saying that avoiding the void must bring happiness. Okay, so this is very clever here, but we say that has to bring, vanity has to bring happiness, because the alternative is void, and that can't be happiness. So vanity must be happiness. Remember, though, there is no void. So this whole line of reasoning and logic is kaput. You know, it's invalid. Vanity does not have to bring happiness. In fact, it doesn't. There is no void. Now, this sounds very simple, and it is, but only right habits of attention can bring one to this, to be able to look at it like this and see how simple it is. Because it means, wow, success is just right here. I mean, I can, you know, step right into perfect happiness. Yeah. And like, we're afraid of that, of course. Which is why then we say, but we understand that I have a severe continuity problem. So I'm not so worried about this, because the Holy Spirit knows I have a severe continuity problem. I know I have it. So even if I do step into, you know, pure happiness, I might back off of it a little bit. But don't say, okay, I understand it's a continuity problem. You just work with this continuity issue. Gradually you get closer and closer and closer. There isn't any other way. It's easy for logic, the intellect, to say, oh no, I can figure it all out. Yeah, so what? You can figure out the basics of it, but you're not, you know, the one who's going to experience the perfect happiness. That's the issue. Not the intellectual rhetoric around it, but the experiencing of it is the issue. That's what we're afraid of. And we're so used to determinism, we say, well, we're perfectly happy. We say, well, wait a minute. How did I determine this? And how do I make it better? You know, in other words, determine the future from this. It's too perfect. I don't feel like it's determined at all. And then we think if it's not determined at all, it's going to suddenly end up into a void. We're going to plunge into a void. And then we panic and we drop it. So we're just looking at the root of this here, that's all. Don't have to do anything with it at this point. We're just looking at it here. The humor, say, oh, that's funny. You have to keep a sense of humor. And have a chuckle at it, you know, because it's silly, you know, it's silly, and yet it's still kind of there and something to chuckle at. And of course, when you can laugh at something, the less power it has over you, right? Or laugh along with it, whatever. Less it has you in its grip. I often find that the reactions that I have show up in like the sinus cavity in the nose. So I'm like suddenly an intense burning, you know, in the nose or something. Or like, it's like, wow, where'd that come from? Just suddenly shows up very, very quickly. A lot of people have sinus problems, for sure. Very intense burn, but able to just stay with it. So, This is all very simple to talk about, but the reactions will come. And the spiritual path has to recognize we have this. It's really about the continuity problem and the void fear mutually reinforcing one another. And therefore, since it's a familiarity continuity issue, it takes a while. It takes a while. It's not going to just vanish. Theoretically, it can. But, and sometimes when there's a culture built up of this, and there's tremendous faith and tremendous results in a culture and in a spiritual lineage, it can seem a lot easier. It can seem a lot easier, for sure. And there are those who may have succeeded in past lives to come back to help out the lineage, keep perpetuated. And so they're already enlightened, and then later on, maybe they're a young person or something, and they'll just then show that, yeah, I'm enlightened. I don't have any fear of continuity, fear, any fear of the void. I'm inherently aware of the inherent greatness of reality. And people say, oh, you did it so fast. No, they came back, you know, came back to help out. And it's understood in those lineages that this happens, like Tibetan Buddhism is one of them, for example. It's understood. So they don't draw any wrong conclusions. They don't say, oh, that means that it should be easy for everybody. They say, no, you're the reincarnation of someone who's already enlightened, helping us by being here. But until we're enlightened, it is this laborious process, laborious situation of getting our attention to these issues here, central issues, evaporating the reaction to them. Evaporate the reaction to them. It's an evaporative process, the spiritual path. Smoothing out, ironing out the wrinkles, so to speak, of reaction. Ironing out the wrinkles of reaction. Not just avoiding what's bringing about the reaction, is purposefully focusing on what's going to bring about these reactions of, trepidation, so that we can see the wrinkles and iron them out. Let it evaporate, purposefully focusing our attention on this. You see, most people say, no, the way is just to avoid this altogether, and I won't feel any fear. And that's then they're stuck in vanity. In other words, embrace the continuity of fear, make it more. Avoid happiness. Embrace failure. They think that's the road. And so this is the difference between in the world, between the wheat and the weeds. The weeds are the ones who are going to continue to pursue vanity, continue to pursue failure, continue to embrace the continuity of fear and say, no, we're going to keep this. We don't need to go back to perfection, inherent greatness of reality. We're going to continue our fear of the void. We're going to try to make determinancy permanent. We're going to continue to try to worship some savior figure that we think has made determinancy permanent for us. You know, they say, well, God gave his only son to die for us. Meaning, what's death? Determinancy. So God so loved the world. God so loved the world of what? Determinancy? That he decided to make determinancy permanent? See, he's looking at it like this. You just have to chuckle. The world is not determinate, actually. God can't make anything determinate. Reality, nature, reality is indeterminate. God can't make anything die. Nothing can die. There's never been any death. In order for there to be death, there would have to be determinancy, right? If every moment is completely free and clear of every other moment, how could there be death? There's nothing to die. If you look at it, you realize that. Nothing has ever died. But we're hoping that God loves this world of what we think is determinancy, and so God's going to decide, you know, for the sake of my human children down there, I'm going to make this world of determinancy permanent for them, because that's what they want. Always keep your sense of humor on the path. It is absolutely essential to not get stuck in a defensive position, defending determinacy. Because then you're trying to solve effects at the level of effects. Go up higher to the cause, and then you'll have a good laugh at it. And you won't be angry at yourself. You say, yeah, oh, I used to think that way. But that's because I didn't realize this continuity fear issue and how to manage it. I didn't know how to manage my success. That's really the only problem there is in the world, in this situation, is we don't know how to manage our success. The real helpful teachers are those who figured out, understood, learned how to manage their success to the point where they're able to accept effortless success, which is the inherent greatness of reality. So everybody has the same problem, really. They have a continuity problem, which is really about learning how to manage your success. As long as we're attracted to vanity and body, we're not learning how to manage our success at all. We're learning how to manage our failure. Again, everybody has the same problem. They're very poor managers of success. Very, very poor at it. You don't get good at it without practicing. You don't get good at it by plunging into vanity. Nobody does. Because that scatters your attention. And you become very, very poor managers of success. So there is a spiritual path. It's all about becoming a manager, successful manager of your success, your true success, which is to drop the belief in determinancy. First the belief in indeterminacy, and then ultimately don't even need any belief at all. Supernature is just a belief in indeterminacy. That's all it is. Whereas nature is the belief in determinacy, supernature is the belief in indeterminacy. It's still a belief system. And ultimately, you don't even need a belief system at all. But again, we need this intermediate step. We're so used to belief that, so the belief in indeterminacy is supernature. That's what Jesus says. Hey, that's what you have to do. That's the next step. Believe in indeterminacy. Which is why he did do some miracles, just to show us, hey, look, this is what the belief in indeterminacy. If you want evidence of it, that there's such is possible, okay, I'll show you some evidence here. But he said, that's not the goal. The goal isn't to go around healing people. The goal is to not changing wine into water into wine. The goal is to choose supernature, the belief system of indeterminacy. It's a very simple belief system. Which is why he said when he came back, he's not here to come back to rule over the kingdom of determinacy. He's here to say, okay, are you ready for the, have you exchanged your belief in determinacy for the belief in indeterminacy? Because the belief in indeterminacy opens you up to the realm of supernature, which he said is my dwelling place for you, that I've made this dwelling place for you. For you to dwell there with me, as then we continue to manage our success ultimately by dwelling in such a situation with such a belief system. Ultimately, we don't need any belief system at all. It's the last vestige of determinacy, isn't it? Even the belief in indeterminacy. But we're not asked to throw that up, you know, give that up. We're not asked to give that up. It's, as Jesus says, it's the illusion that dispels all other illusions. And once all our illusions are dispelled, then it's very easy to set this final illusion down, which is that somehow reality needs our belief in reality in order to be real, which is not true. Reality, as I say, reality doesn't need a realizer of reality.